Thanks everyone for registering and participating in this open session on OpenRAN. We have got 1000 plus registration and more than 300 people joined the session. If you're watching this video on our LinkedIn or Facebook page, please look at the first comment for the complete recording of the session. If you're watching this on our YouTube channel, request you to like the video as well as subscribe our channel and press on the bell notification so that you can get the early notification for all our future videos. So let's get started. Can do it. So welcome everyone. I hope you are able to hear me, right? So just say yes in the chat box so that we can get started. Now, is it okay? Great. Yeah, sorry. I just forgot to unmute myself. Right. So I request everyone to visit our YouTube channel, which is with the name of Learn 5G, like our video, subscribe to our channel, as well as you can press the bell notification for the early notification for all our future videos. Today's session, the agenda is going to be RAN evolution, which we are going to talk from. We are going to talk from 2G to 5G. What is Open RAN and why it is important? Fundamentals of Open RAN, standardization bodies of Open RAN, TEP and ORAN Alliance, and finally, we are going to talk about architecture of Open RAN. Stay connected with us. You can do that by connecting to me on LinkedIn. The link for my LinkedIn profile and our company profile will be shared by my colleague Kuldeep in the chat box. You can look at that. You can visit our YouTube channel and then subscribe to it for all our future videos and our past sessions. And you can also connect to us on Telegram, where we can actually share the real-time information about our blogs, about our courses and stuff like that. Few important points to note here. This is an open session, so we may not get into deep tech concepts. So we are not going to get into the deep technical details of ORAN or any other topic for that matter, but we will keep it at a very, very high level because our audience is very diverse in the technical details, right? So we'll not get into so many deep technical. Just make yourself muted all the times. Whenever you want to speak, you can actually raise your hand. We will unmute you and then you can ask your questions. And during the session, please type your questions in the chat box so that we can take up those questions at the in between the session or at the end of the session. Right, so we are recording the session and we will be sharing the recording link with all the participants. So we will have a question and answer session at the end of the session. We will be uploading this particular video on the YouTube and link will be shared. And if you have any other information, please write to us at 5gtraining@nanocellnetworks.com, or you can visit our website, which is nanocellnetworks.com. Right. A bit about NanoCell, I'll not spend much time, just 2 more minutes. And we are actually aligned with a company called CVIT, which is building India's own 5G testbed, where we have end-to-end testbed details. We deliver a lot of technologies, trainings on telecom. We are delivering a lot of trainings on the telecom technologies, data science, cloud, network, and cybersecurity and soft skills. These are some of our major customers: Ericsson, Samsung, Accenture, MDogs, Qualcomm, Nokia. So all these companies, we are working with all their telecom training requirements. These are a list of our courses where we have very, very customized courses depending on the target audience, starting from business leaders to the non-technical people to the deep technical courses on 5G radio, 5G core, 5G transport, and Open RAN. If you really need more information about any of our courses, you can write us an email at 5gtraining@nanocellnetworks.com. We are coming up with a new open course, which is going to be a paid course in the second week of June, which will be having a 16 hours of online live courses, online live content, where we'll talk about introduction to 5G, 5G new radio and air interface, 5G network architecture, and 5G protocol and procedures. Normally, these kind of courses are actually priced at $1,099 or maybe more than that. But just for our introductory price, we are offering this course and in US dollar 199, which is approximately $200. If you really need any more information on this, you can actually visit our website or actually email us at 5gtraining@nanocellnetworks.com. So that's all from my side. Let's get started. I'll hand it over to Devdas, who is taking care of this technical session today. And if you have any question, please write your question in the chat box and we can take up the question whenever time allows. Devdas, over to you. I hope you're able to hear me.
Thank you, Sanjay, for the introduction. Am I audible?
Yeah, please go ahead. Yeah, good to go. Yeah.
So is my screen visible?
Not as of now. Yep, we can see that.
That's visible?
Yes, now we can see your screen. Great, go ahead.
So to all the participants on this session, good morning, good afternoon, good evening. Thanks for your interest to know a little bit more about Open RAN. We will try to provide as many details as possible in the given time and agenda. Just to make sure that you are aware of what is expected out of this course, Sanjay has given us some idea about what are we going to talk about in next 1 hour. Myself, Devdas Pai, I have spent about 20 years in telecom industry now. My focus area has been mostly on the RAN since, for almost all part of my career. I have been into teaching profession since last 11 years, focusing on 3G, 4G, and since last 2 years on 5G. And again, in 5G, I have been following Open RAN since last 1 year. It's quite an interesting topic. I'm sure with the same enthusiasm, you have also decided to attend this session. So to start, I have similar agenda as what Sanjay has mentioned. I hope all of you are able to listen to, you are able to hear me clearly, and you're also able to see the screen. That's with that assumption, I will, continue. This is the agenda, broad agenda that I have with respect to today's session. We will talk about how RAN got evolved from 2G to 5G. We'll also talk about what are all the limitations or what are all the challenges telcos have with the earlier RAN architecture.
Devdas, sorry to interrupt you. Can you just run your slides in the slide mode? It will help us to look at these things clearly.
Yeah, basically, I wanted to write Sanjay on these slides.
Right.
No, so I'll try my level best to enlarge. Yeah. So I was talking about why operators are interested in Open RAN. What is that suddenly making this entire telco industry talking about Open RAN? Since last 25 years or 30 years, there is absolutely no news on Open RAN. So we are now suddenly seeing a great interest among operators across the world on Open RAN. So we will talk about that. And then we will talk about what is ORAN, how ORAN architecture is, and what are all the components of ORAN network, what are all the interfaces we have opened within the RAN so that there are multiple players can come in the RAN domain. Because as of now, without ORAN, RAN domain is dominated by 3 or 4 players in the world. So that makes operators, a little bit dependent on these players. So more and more suppliers are really welcome for this industry. So especially from telco's perspective, telecom operators. We'll also talk about the role played by 3GPP and ORAN Alliance in breaking the RAN open, and what exactly they are doing in the ORAN domain. And then we will talk about ORAN within the radio network, how they have split the radio into control plane, user plane. Some of those who may not have an idea of control plane, user plane, Not worry, we will discuss when we talk about that topic. And then we will talk about what are all the areas of contribution by various organizations within the telco space and software services space or R&D space who can actually play a role in ORAN ecosystem. Hopefully by that time, I think we will finish our objective, and then if there are any questions, we will take up. So as Sanjay said, since there is a huge, since there is a large audience, we will try to take all questions at the end. In case if you have any questions, you may please use the chat box and ask those questions. I see some of the participants I have worked with in the past. Some of the participants are our partners. Some of the participants are, you know, our ex-colleagues. So nice to have you all. So with this agenda, we will start. So typical mobile network architecture, if we look at legacy network, we have broadly, we have core network and we have radio network. And core network and radio network are connected through transport network. And then through air interface, we get services on the mobile. This is the typical mobile network architecture, whether it is 2G, 3G, or 4G, or even 5G. This is a broad architecture of a mobile, network, cellular network. And services are built on top of core network. So if we broadly look into this, network is a combination of hardware and software. Whether it is core network, whether it is access network, network is a component which has hardware as well as software. If I bifurcate core network, we have core network hardware, we have radio network hardware, and on top of that, we have core network software and radio network software. Luckily, since last 25-30 years, 3GPP has been focusing on making some of the interfaces open. At least for in 2G, we had core network to radio network, you know, open interface based on SS7. Because of that, it enabled telcos to go for core network solutions from one vendor, radio network solutions from another vendor. So it gave some amount of flexibility to telcos to deploy the network using at least two, three vendors who can supply core network solution and who can supply radio network solution. Having said that, there are many interfaces in the network. We will expand the network and see. But within the core network, the hardware was proprietary, software was proprietary. Within the radio network, hardware was proprietary. Software, hardware, and software both were proprietary. So in a way, telcos had to work with a particular vendor who has supplied these solutions to them for any further upgrade, for any solutions, for additional features and things like that. So this is how 2G, 3G network has been for last 20-25 years. With the 4G, there were some modifications to how the network was built by telcos. First thing with 4G is we tried to bring in some amount of hardware which are commercially off the shelf. Probably not for the entire network, for some part of the network, let's say core network hardware, We tried to introduce cloud platform for implementing core network. So in 4G, but ultimate aim of telcos is to look at whether we can go for completely commercially off the shelf hardware based network. Is there a possibility both for RAN and core network? So how can we achieve this objective? So end of the day, operators want to implement network on commercially off the shelf open source hardware instead of going with the purpose built hardware provided by a particular vendor. So that's the broad statement that we have. So in 4G, we made some attempts to achieve this objective. What did we do in 4G? We said we will try part by part. We will not go at one go and try to achieve this objective. So in 4G, core network, today we have virtual EPC solutions. Virtual EPC solution can be basically implemented on open source hardware, where telecom OEMs are expected to provide software based EPC, virtual EPC solution. So majority of the telecom OEMs provided this service or solution to telcos across the world. If we look at, there are about 1,000 operators, telecom operators across the world, and majority of those operators who are having 4G network, today they have virtual EPCs in their network, virtual EPC in their network, which is built on a cloud platform. Wherein, when we come to radio, the radio network architecture basically followed a little bit different architecture than 2G and 3G. In 2G and 3G, base station is one single platform where we had all components built into one particular platform, and radio was one unit where you have baseband, processors, RF components, everything built into it in 2G and 3G. When it comes to 4G, we made one step further evolution in the radio, and we said some part of the radio which are basically meant for baseband processing, which is called baseband unit, was separated from the base station, and that was mostly doing majorly computing and those aspects, majorly computing related. And the RF component of the base station was separated and named it as remote radio unit. So this was a next step that we did in 4G, wherein remote radio unit could be fixed on top of the tower, telecom tower, and at the bottom of telecom tower we had just BBU, baseband unit. That was one step further towards making radio network also a virtual based radio network. But we couldn't achieve that with that kind of architecture. So we had to move further from splitting from BBU to RRU to one more next architecture called centralized radio, centralized BBU, and then the remote radios. So in 4G, this is, we have three options we could see here in this picture. Option A, option B, and option C. So each of these options is an evolution in the RAN itself. So what did we do? If we look at the option one on the leftmost side, you will see option one, option two, option three, option four. This is how the RAN got evolved. Let me explain each of these options. So in 2G and 3G, radio base station was one unit, and base station was connected to antenna using RF cables. So entire component, base station component, was housed within the base station, which used to be below the tower. On top of the tower, there used to be simple antennas which used to radiate electromagnetic waves. So this was a traditional base station architecture and implementation. So with 4G, what we could do, option two, with 4G, what we could do was we could split the base station into two components. If you see, there are two components of radio. One is BBU, the other one is called RRUs, remote radio unit. So BBU and remote radio units are now two separate components of a base station, and they are not in one box, they are now separated. Now what goes into RRU and what goes into BBU? RRU is typically all RF components, radio frequency related components, are RRUs, and computing related and O&M related, all these components are in BBU, which means in a way BBU didn't have RF related component built into it. RRU is in the option two. RRU is typically installed on top of the tower next to the antenna, and BBU is typically below the tower. So that was the beginning of splitting the RAN. That was just the beginning of splitting the RAN. But the point here is RRU and BBU did not have an open interface. RRU and BBU had a proprietary interface, which means a telco still had to go to one OEM or one vendor for both BBU and RRU solution. They could not go to two different vendors for implementing RRU and BBU. But the next step after this BBU and RRU split was having the BBU in a centralized location. Having BBU in a centralized location instead of near the tower, and only RRUs are installed at every base station location. With this, we had to go for a new interface between baseband and RRU. With that, we introduced something called front haul. Front haul interface between BBU pool or RRU was still a proprietary interface. Such kind of RAN, we call them as centralized RAN, wherein we have processors, computing built in the central, location, to which we could connect multiple RRUs, who are basically those RRUs which are built, which are installed near the tower. So with this, we introduced a new transport network component in the mobile network called FrontHaul. And we had a new protocol called CIPRI there. I'm sure majority of you are aware. So we could manage this connectivity well. Still, the radio network was built in the centralized RAN. Still, the radio network was built on a proprietary hardware provided by a vendor. When I say radio network, both baseband as well as RRU were provided by one vendor because the front hall was still proprietary interface. What was the next step in 4G is basically, since BBU is mostly compute based, everything is compute based. So in 4G network, we tried to virtualize BBU. We tried to implement BBU on cloud platform. That was the next big thing that happened, which we call it as vRAN today, wherein vRAN doesn't necessarily mean open RAN. vRAN just conveys that BBU is now built on cloud platform, where a particular vendor who is actually offering RU solution now is offering BBU software, which can be implemented on a commercially off the shelf or open source hardware. So this is the beginning of disaggregating hardware and software in the radio. In the core network in LTE, we did that, where entire now EPC can be, or the entire LTE core network can be on the cloud. Now with the implementation of vRAN, we started implementing BBU on cloud platform, which is a big step by itself in the RAN space. Having said that, the interface between virtual BBU and RRU is still proprietary, which means the virtual BBU software, which is provided by a particular OEM, has to have RRU supplied by them. So still an operator has a vendor lock-in. There's a vendor lock-in in radios, in the radio network. So we have now an idea of how radio network architecture got evolved from a pure proprietary based hardware and proprietary based software to a RAN split in option two. And from RAN split to having a centralized BBU in option three, which introduced FrontHaul, which is again a proprietary. And then in option four, we could go for virtualized BBU. So what next? So where are we with respect to vRAN? With respect to vRAN today, we are having open source hardware. We are having open source hardware almost till the radio centralized unit, right? In the core network, we have open source hardware. In the radio network, on one component, we have open source hardware. But both BBU and RU had to come from the same vendor, right? So the problem is the RAN open yet? Now RAN is not open yet. Why do we want RAN to be open? What is that driving operator to go for open RAN? What is the objective? What is the motivation? So there are some organizations who have been, we will talk about it, which are all those organizations who are actually driving the Open RAN initiative.